Sometimes I like to make funny faces before the camera starts. Sharon Horne-Ellstrom here. Day 687 of What's She Up To Now. She, of course, is Sharon Horne-Ellstrom. Best thing about being married was I got to change my initials from when I hyphenated my name in corporate America. Silly thing. We think we need to do things when we do them, and then we, you know, about a week into it, we're like, oh my God, why did I do that? Why did I hyphenate my name? But since I'm divorced, it was a good thing I hyphenated my name. Plus, I still like my initials. She are cool initials. I like them. What am I up to? Holy moly. For some reason, the word organized is all over my brain this morning. And I think it's because it's the holidays and it's a busy time of year for all of us. And it's the end of the year, so we're ramping down things. And I moved, and it was a crazy, crazy busy year. Lots happened this year, a ton. Good and bad, like every year. Things have happened, not necessarily to me, but to me and to people around me. Excuse me, people I love and care about, like this coal that we keep passing back and forth to amongst our troops. But I'm thinking about organized, and my question for you is, are you an organizer? Would you, well, number one, are you organized? And number two, are you an organizer? I, in corporate America, was like a killer organizer, and I was super duper organized. And as I moved into running my own businesses, I progressively became less and less organized on a personal level. My businesses were always organized, but on a personal level and at home, less and less organized because I took more and more time away and forgot that if I organize something and I have it set up right in the first place, everything else falls into place and is so much easier. If everything has a place, and there's a place for everything, and everything has a place, and everybody knows that place, everything stays clean and organized and easier to access and quicker to deal with than if everything is haphazard and random. And I'm wondering, do you operate that way? Do you operate that way? Now, you can take this too far. I have a relative that organizes to the point of labeling everything. Every cupboard, every shelf, every drawer has a label on it. And that's awesome for communicating to other people, but it's also, I couldn't live with that person. I mean, you can't ever change your mind unless you peel off the labels and move stuff around. And I do like to move stuff around and continually improve. So as I find a better way to organize and do something, I want to be able to just do it. I don't want to have to be peeling off labels. But I do love when I go to their cabin that there's labels because you know where everything belongs and where everything goes. And you know how to find everything and put it back where it belongs. So say you go to a cupboard or the toolbox and you take something out and you're like, geez, I can't remember what drawer the hammer goes in. Well, it says hammer, so you know exactly where to put the hammer back. So there's always an upside to everything. But how organized are you? Are you organized enough? And you only need to be organized enough to make your life work smoothly and to reduce your stress and overwhelm and to make things more efficient for yourself. So you don't have to be, it's going to be a little bit different for each of us, the level of organization that we want to have in our life. I am at a point in my life right now where, obviously, since organized is at the top of my mind when I wake up, I am not organized enough as I'm transitioning through this move. This physical move from home to home to home is it's a lot of upheaval, and I don't like it. I like to be more organized than that. I like to have a more routine, more structured, planned out existence. And so I think I'm gonna actually devote some time and energy today to making things the way I want them, organizing them and setting them up for my success and my ease and to reduce my stress and blood pressure, which is part of the blood pressure challenge. I am on day 81 of the blood pressure challenge today, and we're talking about processes and how we do things. So that is maybe why I'm thinking about getting organized, more organized, and organizing my current location. Even if it's temporary, I like it to be organized. So I got a lot of work to do in that area. But I love doing it. It's fun to organize. I like organizing it because then I can delegate it and have someone else do it, because I don't really love doing it. I like setting it up and then letting someone else maintain it. That's me in a nutshell. I like creating things and then letting somebody else actually do the operation of that thing that's been created. Everything but the kitchen sink was the topic of Supersize Your Business, and then just my Facebook Live this morning, just talking about where did that saying come from, what does it mean? And it's really fun because it's a saying I have a lot of experience with, especially given my most recent move and then the moves of my mom and dad before my dad died 5 years ago. About 5 years before that, or maybe longer, they needed to move out of their hobby farm of 40, 45 years they'd lived there. And we'd all grown up there, my sisters and I, and a lot of our friends. And they had, outbuildings, a three-story barn. They had a two-story garage with a big loft and a room on the back of it. And a big, not just a little house, a big farmhouse. And from, southern style farmhouse, I love that house. I still dream in that house. It's really funny. My memory bank, since I grew up there, one of the memory tricks I learned a long, long time ago as a young person was to remember things, you put them in different rooms of your house. That's how you can help organize your brain to retrieve information more quickly. And I learned that probably in high school or in college. And I used that house as my memory house. So even though that house has been burned down and is now a hospital and a home for the aged and a memory care and all kinds of things, it's a great Presbyterian home. It's an amazingly beautiful place. I still use that house in my imagination as my location of things that I want to retrieve from my memory. So I see it plain as day as if it were still there when I was living there, even though it no longer exists. It still exists in my imagination. And I suspect it still exists in the minds and hearts of all the members of my family. It was an amazing place to grow up. So everything but the kitchen sink. That's a fun expression. I would love to know if you have any experience with that expression. I am having so much fun, and I'm going to stop doing it pretty soon because it's not really the direction I want to go, but I've had a lot of fun. I think today was day 288, so I've done 288 different idioms or expressions, what they mean, where they come from, and how you can apply them to your life or your business. That's just been a topic, and I started doing it at the beginning, not quite the beginning of the year. It must have been a little ways into the year. I don't even remember why I started doing it. I think it's because I was preparing to move and I needed to move, but I wanted to continue to create content every day. And so I thought, well, what's a way to create content? Well, I found this little book of idioms and I thought, well, this is really interesting. We know that words have power over us based on how we define them and the meaning we give to them. Well, that means that all of these expressions and idioms and sayings have that much power or even more because they've been a part of our existence and other people have defined them for us over sometimes centuries or thousands of years. So I've really had a good time doing it, but I know probably going into next year, I'm not gonna do that anymore. I'm gonna do something totally different with both my Supersize Your Business group and with my targeting. I'm doing a 7-day challenge right now called Field of Favor. And I was like, can't even say field of favor. It's day 3 today, but it's what I've been teaching people yet haven't been doing myself, and so I'm kind of kicking myself. And today we have to do a video about the fear of selecting our field of favor, favor or something. I can't even say it right. But it's really an interesting topic. It's got a very big religious or spiritual spin to it, which I think people can and cannot relate to. As far as the religious part of it goes, I no longer relate to that. The spiritual part of it, the overall aspect of it, I totally relate to and I get. So I'm actually really enjoying it. It's Pedro Eldo and I don't know how to pronounce his name, and Jason Fladian are doing it. And I saw it the day before it started and I'm like, I might jump on that. So I jumped on that and it's really interesting. Love the instruction, love the teaching. It's a little longer than I like. Personally, because you have to devote like at least an hour and a half, 2 hours to it, because that's how long the calls have been so far. I don't know if today's will be as long, but if it's something that's important to you, it's something that you want to achieve in a short period of time, challenges are absolutely positively the best way to do that. In 7 days, I know with certainty that I will have already picked my field of favor and I will be going after that personally from now on. And it's something I've been toying with the idea of for 686 days at least now, and that's not okay. Maybe this documenting my journey would have stopped already if I had found my field of favor 18 months ago or whatever. So it's a really interesting topic that I was just unaware of. I had never heard it described or taught this way, and so I'm really enjoying it. It's a level of depth that most people never go to on the topic of selecting who you're going to serve. Who are you here to serve? Who do you want to work with? Yet, this is the first thing that every person and every business needs to decide. And it's the deep dive that I was missing that I wish I would have had when I decided I was going to do something online. I actually wish I would have known about it when I decided what I was going to do offline, what businesses I was or wasn't going to get involved in. Probably would have saved me at least 20 different business tries, right? Or 20 different industries. I could have just said, yep, this is where I belong. This is what I'm going to do. This is where I fit. I wouldn't have had to try to figure that out by trial and error and going into different businesses and different industries and finding out where does it feel the best? What feels good? What doesn't feel good? You know, doing it by trial and error always takes longer. So I'm sure I'll be talking a little bit more about that over the next couple of days as I go through the challenge. But today is all about the fears associated with that. And it's interesting because it's we all have the same fears of everything. Fear of not being good enough, fear of not deserving, fear of what other people will think or rejection or ridicule, fear of loss of love. It all, everything that we do, at least everything I do, boils down to the same couple of fears. And they're fears that are ridiculous. On a conscious level, I know it's ridiculous to think about that. I remember one of my biggest fears of doing video was I'm old, I'm not good looking, I'm scared to have my face or my voice, my gravel gritty voice some days on video. And that prevented me from doing videos at all for like at least 6 months. I would not pick up a camera and do a video. It was a good 6 months of people pushing and telling me you gotta do video, you gotta do video, you gotta do video before I got up the guns and the gumption to actually do a video. And I kind of tricked myself into it by actually doing a 365-day challenge on doing one thing every day that scares you. From this little journal book, do one thing every day that scares you. And I did this. I just happen to have it sitting here. But I had started this book with another woman like a couple of times before. We never finished it. And I committed to myself, and it was my way of committing to myself that I was going to do video every day for a year. So I did a video every day for a year based on this book. And I think it was longer than a year. I think it ended up being 378 days in the book, and it's maybe even longer than that because I went back and I started from the beginning again then, because I had started and stopped this book like 7 times because I never committed to myself that I would actually do it. I actually bought it for a friend because I knew that we both needed to stretch our comfort zone. We were in a network marketing business. Actually in a network marketing business. And we were both scared to do the things that they were teaching us to do. Now, we were scared to do the things they were teaching us to do because they were stupid, old school, terrible ways of selling any product or service or business opportunity to anyone on the planet. But back then, I didn't know better. So I'd gotten this book. We did it. So that's part of how I got over my fear of video, was doing a challenge on myself, making myself, challenging myself to actually take action every day and do it. And that led to the do one thing every day that makes you happy. Today was day 348 of that. This will wrap up. It should wrap up at about the end of the year, but I think it'll go a little bit past because if I'm only on day 348, there's 369 things in here. I do think I overlapped a little bit with this. I did start this January 1st, I'm pretty sure. Let me just take a peek back. Yep, 1119. Started it, 1119. And measured my happiness quotient. At the beginning of the year, it was at a 5. And then I think the last activity in this is to measure it again. What's your happiest quotient at the end of the year? That would be day 369. And then, guess what? I've already got next year's picked up one because one thing, I want to stop doing the idioms, I think, and replace that with something else for my business folks and my business clients. But I still like to do something every day, and this is a secret. I actually started doing this one, to do one thing every day that makes you happy. Number one, I wanted to feel happier this year, right? We all can win and have a happier life if we choose to. And if I do one thing every day to make sure I'm focusing on things that can make me happy, things that normally I would ignore or I would let negative things that happen outside of me impact me, it reminds me to not do that. And so I like doing this every day. And the secret is I like doing this video every day first because it wakes up my voice. This is actually this do one thing every day that makes you happy and do one thing every day that scares you. And next year it's going to be, secret reveal, do one thing do one fun thing every day. It's gonna be next year. And I haven't looked at this. I had the creative one I was gonna do this year, and it was just, and I might not be able to do this one either, because it's a lot of activity type things. So unless people want to get the book, it might not be as valuable or fun. I'll figure out a way to make it fun. Because it's all about the fun. So next year, starting on the 1st, I will do one fun thing every day. Because now that I'm stretching my comfort zone, which I'm continually doing, and found out ways to be happier every day, and I'll continue to do that. After 365 days of looking for something every day to be happy about, do you think I'm just going to stop doing it at the end of the year? I don't think that's possible. Do you think I've stopped stretching my comfort zone at the end of last year? Absolutely not. It's not possible. Do you think I'll stop having fun after 2020? No, I'll probably be a heck of a lot more fun and a lot less boring than I have been up until this point, if you ask my children. So, organize. In order to be happy, stretch my comfort zone, and have fun, I need to be more organized, be a better organizer. It's funny, I'm good at organizing other people and other things and businesses, not so much organizing myself. And I need to bring more of that into my personal life, because the more organized and the better I feel. The more organized I am, the better I feel. More in control. And don't we all want some control over our life? Some people thrive on random and problem solving, and I'm really good at that. And so I've survived on that for a long time. But as I get older, I want things to be less chaotic, less random, less crazy all the time. Curious what you think and how you feel about that, and how organized you think you are. On a scale of 1 to 10, how organized do you think you are? And you can do that with respect to different aspects of your life. How organized are you at work? How organized are you with your business or your job? How organized are you with schedules, personal activities? And you know, if you're a mom with kids and all the different activities, man, you've got to be organized. You've got to have at least a calendar with all that written down. Whatever works for you. Pick a system and whatever works for you. There's all kinds of systems and tools out there, especially on our phones these days with all the apps and things, the reminders. Oh my gosh, I wish we would have had some of those things when I was raising my kids. I would have been on time a whole lot more often. At least I would have had a chance of being on time a lot more often. So that's it. If I can help you in any way, hit me up in the comments below. Voxer, I love Voxer. Pajamagramma on Voxer. V-O-X-E-R is an app that's a walkie-talkie app. Or message me and just ask the question. Never hurts to ask. If I can't help you, I will let you know. I will point you in the right direction, though, to get your question answered. Because I love to do that. I love answering questions and helping people out whenever I can. Have an amazing day, and I will, of course, be with you tomorrow.